Rajiv, just to get your reaction on this arrest, after a lot of questioning and avoiding arrest, he's finally been arrested. Is this the first, perhaps, that we're going to see in a line of action against those involved in this mess?
See, one thing must be noted, and that is that arrest should not be taken in any criminal investigation as a part of punishment or as something to humiliate or condemn somebody as guilty. Because arrest is necessary and only a part of, some kind of a contribution towards furtherance of investigation. Now, naturally, this Mr. Kumar, Anjali Kumar, was being questioned for quite some time prior to his arrest. It is only after questioning him that the investigating officers deemed it fit, according to their duty, that, it would be necessary to arrest him so that we can collect some more information after his arrest by custodial interrogation permissible by law. So that event has occurred today, and we expect that Anjali Kumar, as a law-abiding citizen, even if he may be a suspect or an accused in a crime, is duty-bound to furnish whatever information and or knowledge that he may have in relation to the issues that are connected with the subject matter of the case. And certainly that would be for furtherance of investigation. We'll have to wait and watch as to how the investigation gathers pace after this arrest.
Right, right. So first, when it comes to Anjali Kumar himself, Majid, give me a sense of what are the options available to him at this point. As you said, it's really for the purpose of continuing the investigation under custody. Will he be held under custody? Can he be let out on bail? Is there any? Give us a sense of really what his options are. What happens next at this point?
Now, it's a little too early to prejudge as to what is going to be his fate and how long is he going to rest in custody, because that would all depend upon the progress of the investigation, his cooperation in helping the cause of investigation, and several other facts. But we must not lose sight of the fact that arresting a person should be avoided as far as possible. That is what is our developed criminal jurisprudence, that only in inevitable cases where arrest becomes absolutely necessary that the investigating officers are justified in arresting a person, because arrest is not, as I said earlier, a part of punishment or something to humiliate somebody or to condemn him. He is presumably innocent and a respectable person till the guilt is established. But this, of course, is in order to enable the investigating agency to make progress towards the investigation.
Majid, the fact that he's actually more or less claimed responsibility for his actions in his affidavit, and the fact that this entire scam has been blown completely out of proportion, it is, as you said, it's really not guilty until proven so by the authorities. But in the likelihood of some of that blame being established or that series of offense being established, what is the kind of penalty in a case of this nature?
Now, remember one thing, that if he has admitted anything even in writing to the police, since he has been an accused in a criminal prosecution, the admissibility of such admission, is lost, because anything that is stated by an accused in custody would not be admissible in law unless it is independently established, that particular fact. But definitely it would be a clue or a guide for the investigating agency to crack the case further from the information that may come through him by way of admissions. Because after all, admission or confession of an accused is inadmissible as far as the it is made to police in custody. So we will have to wait and see now how does he extend assistance and what is the extent of satisfaction by the investigating agency. And sooner or later, he would make an application for bail, and bail would be as a matter of right, because keeping a person in detention at pretrial stage is always to be discouraged in the modern criminal jurisprudence.
Okay, right. Majid, just do stay with us, because from what you're saying, it sounds like this case could once again see many more twists and turns going forward. Let me just also bring in Mr. Kirat Somaiya, who's also joining us on the phone line. Mr. Somaiya, let me just first get your reaction to this arrest. What do you see this as an indication of? Do you see this as regulators being on the right track? Or are you, as Mr. Memon just said, also waiting to see how this actually pans out? Will this result in more arrests going forward?
I think at last, activism of media and people like us not now getting the result. This is the first major arrest. But I think now, Jignesh will have to go inside. But whatever now the course of action should be to get the property bank accounts of all the borrowers and Jignesh, where the Jignesh had transferred the money, that should be attached immediately. So, and you may be knowing that on 21st October, the Mumbai High Court is once again listening the matter. During the last hearing, Justice Wajib Dar came down very heavily on the system, on the respondent, including the Government of India. So I'm very much sure on 21st, the court will ask the government about the explanation, why Jignesh, what action against Jignesh has taken, and what about the money?
Absolutely. So a lot of questions still unanswered here, Mr. Somaiya. What we're really exploring here also, as you said, activism has led to, of course, some amount of action being taken. But in the future, how does one prevent something of this scale, really? What would you like to see done by regulators in this case?
Actually, now the investigators are a little bit confused. Because they know. The beginning of this scam took place on 5th June 2007 when in illegal manner the exemption was allowed. In 2011, the government filed papers noting clear-cut says that the FMC and other activists, all the people, the competitive exchanges have brought to the notice of the government that the scam is going on and this is nothing but a Ponzi scheme. For your information, I'm going on record on the day one, that is in July beginning, when I met the government official and I told them this is nothing but Ponzi scheme. The government official agreed with me. Yes, Mr. Somaiya, you are correct. In beginning of April 2013, the government has asked income tax to visit few of the warehouses. And the income tax has given report, 1300 pages report. This is a bogus receipt. There are no warehouses. There are no stock. The government was knowing since 2011, 2012, 2013, April. It was reconfirmed. Then also from April to September, 4 months, the government allowed the scamsters to transfer the money. And we are going to ask the government who will be paid for this money.
Absolutely. We've seen with some of the biggest scams in the country, let's take a Satyam for instance, it's taken a long time for us to see accountability or for us to see justice being done at the final stage. How long do you anticipate something like this, which is fairly complicated, to really drag on? How long could it possibly drag on?
No, let us make it sure that now that the investigation has taken place, the matter would be adjudicated also faster, and only the first requirement of interest of justice would be to ensure that the small investors, you know, who may have put in all their life's earning, should get their money back with whatever legitimate interest that they are entitled to. I think that would meet the aims of justice.